So recently, everyone has been talking about AI, and it's quite amazing the impact AI has made to the world. And it's now much more noticeable right now because there are front-end connections between users and AI. And one popular product of AI is ChatGPT and Google Bard. And one of the reasons why this is so fascinating right now for people is because they can easily interact with these large language models, which are a byproduct of artificial intelligence.
Before it takes what you prompt it with and just runs with it. From one perspective, it's a tool, a thing you can use to get useful tasks done in language. From another perspective, it's a system that can make dreams, thoughts, ideas flourish in text in front of you.
GPT-4 is incredibly advanced and sophisticated. It can take in and generate up to 25,000 words of text, around 8 times more than ChatGPT. It understands images and can express logical ideas about them. For example, it can tell us that if the strings in this image were cut, the balloons would fly away.
GPT-4 can teach a huge range of subjects. Imagine giving a fifth grader a personal math tutor with unlimited time and patience. It's a great tool to bring learning to everyone in a way that is personalized to their skill level.
Today, I want to explore AI with you. Its rich history, its various types and groundbreaking applications and thought-provoking future possibilities, because there are lots of that. So if you are new here, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, click the notification bell so you won't miss out on any of our thrilling discussion relating to AI, computational linguistics, and robotics. All right, let's dive in and embark on this extraordinary sort of intellectual adventure together. Visionaries like Alan Turing and John McCarthy, these two guys were really great scientists. Turing had this brilliant idea of making a machine that could simulate human intelligence. He called it the Universal Turing Machine. And then there's McCarthy, who is basically one of the fathers of artificial intelligence. He practically coined the word artificial intelligence and developed the first programming language, Lisp, that was used. And it became the standard in AI research. It's amazing to think about how these early ideas led to the AI we know today. Most of the ideas that have been implemented today and used are actually ideas that date far back. Now, you may be wondering why AI wasn't so popular like 20 years back. One of the reasons it was so, it's because right now in 2023, 2022, it's amazing the amount of data that are available that can be used at training set, and also the large amount of computing resources that are available right now.
Have you ever seen a polar bear playing bass? Or a robot painted like a Picasso? Didn't think so. DALL-E 2 is a new AI system from OpenAI that can take simple text descriptions like a koala dunking a basketball and turn them into photorealistic images that have never existed before. DALL-E 2 can also realistically edit and retouch photos based on a simple natural language description. It can fill in or replace part of an image with AI-generated imagery that blends seamlessly with the original. It's called inpainting.
As AI evolved, two main categories emerged. We have the narrow AI and general AI. Now, narrow AI really excels in a specific task. Now, think about speech recognition, playing chess, or recognizing faces in photos. Remember IBM's Deep Blue defeating world chess champion Gary back then, right? That's narrow AI in action, really. And then there's general AI, which actually aims to replicate the human intelligence across a wide range of tasks and not just one task. It's still an elusive goal for us, but advancements like OpenAI ChatGPT are getting us really closer to this idea, and people are developing tools and models that can actually begin to mimic humans in a large array of tasks. Now, this brings us to machine learning, which is the core of AI. It's all about teaching computers to learn from data. Just like we learn from our experiences, the computer learns to learn from the data it's exposed to. By processing tons of information, adapting their behavior based on specific data or sensors they get, there are different techniques like supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning, each having its own unique approach. You may be wondering what these techniques are. I'm glad you are so curious about it. So let me talk about supervised, unsupervised, and deep reinforcement learning in a way that will keep you on the edge and will really come natural. We have supervised learning, which It's like a student-teacher relationship. Imagine you are teaching a child how to recognize different fruits. You pick up an apple, you pick up an orange, you pick up a banana, and each time you show this child these things, you tell the child, this is an apple, this is a banana, this is an orange. That is basically what supervised learning is. Now, just as the child learns from your guidance and starts recognizing fruits on their own, that's similar to supervised learning. Computers are trained using labeled data, meaning that they are both inputs and examples, and the correct output are also given. So the algorithm makes prediction based on what it has learned from the previous things, its mistakes, and eventually gets better at that very task. It's incredibly powerful technique used for things like recognition, speech-to-text, and email filtering.
DALL-E 2 takes the technology even further with higher resolution, greater comprehension, and new capabilities, like in painting. It can even start with an image as an input and create variations with different angles and styles. DALL-E was created by training a neural network on images and their text descriptions.
Next, we have supervised learning, where things really get a bit mysterious. Picture this, you are an archaeologist who just discovered a bunch of ancient artifacts. You don't really know what they are, but you notice similarities and differences among them. You start grouping them in accordance to their feature, like their shapes or material. That's what unsupervised learning really does. It uncovers hidden patterns and structures in unlabeled data. The algorithm tries to sort all this data into clusters or groups them without any guidance from you, the scientist. Like, it is solving a case without any prior knowledge. That is what unsupervised learning actually is. It's used in applications like customer segmentation, anomaly detection, and recommendation systems. Now, finally, we arrive at the reinforcement learning, where the stakes are really high and the rewards are everything. Imagine you are playing a video game, and you're trying to reach the highest score. You learn from trial and error, right? Adapting your strategy based on the points you earn or lose. That's how reinforcement learning works. AI agents learn through interaction with their environment, receiving positive or negative feedback in the form of rewards or penalties. You may be asking, what is the goal of this? The goal of this is actually to maximize the cumulative reward over time. It's like an epic quest where the AI agent constantly hones its skills, navigating the complex environment to achieve its objective. Reinforcement learning has been used in robotics, self-driving cars, and even to create AI that can beat humans at games like Go and Poker. Now, each of these techniques is unique and powerful in its own way, opening doors to a world of possibility for AI to impact our lives. Who knows what groundbreaking discoveries may be awaiting us in 10 to 15 years. But wait, there is more to this. Deep learning.
Like in painting, it can even start with an image as an input and create variations with different angles and styles. DALL-E was created by training a neural network on images and their text descriptions. Through deep learning, it not only understands individual objects, like koala bears and motorcycles, but learns from relationships between objects. And when you ask DALL-E for an image of a koala bear riding a motorcycle, it knows how to create that or anything else with a relationship to another object or action.
Now, deep learning is a subset of machine learning, but it uses artificial neural networks to mimic the human brain's functionality. These networks have layers of interconnected nodes inspired by the neurons we have in our brains, how everything is all wired together. Now, with deep learning, AI systems can analyze complex data and make human-like decisions. We are talking about image and speech recognition, natural language processing, and even artistic style transfers. You've heard of DALL-E? That is made possible by deep learning. You've heard of ChatGPT? That is actually made possible by deep learning. Let's step back. Now, AI is all around us. You may not really notice, but AI is probably glancing at you right now. It's not in a creepy way, but in a useful way. In medicine, it's helping to detect diseases like cancer at an early stage by analyzing medical images. It's also personalizing treatment plans based on the patient's genetic makeup and medical history. In agriculture, AI is actually optimizing crop yields and automating farming processes and predicting the weather patterns. And in finance, AI is revolutionizing the industry with fraud detection, algorithmic trading, and credit scoring. As we look towards the future, AI's potential feels so limitless. Imagine AI understanding and responding to human emotions more effectively. Imagine unlocking the secret of quantum computing, making breakthroughs in molecular biology, and even enhancing human recognition and cognition with brain-computer interfaces. Of course, there are challenges that AI presents, like job automation, privacy issues, and algorithmic biases. These are things we would have to figure out as time goes on, but I don't want you to have the impression that AI is yet to replace us humans. Now, AI, at the end of the day, is going to be just a tool, but a really, really capable tool. Not just some tool, a really, really capable tool. So these are some of the ethical boundaries and ethical planes we have to gradually adapt to. We need to collaborate and develop responsible AI systems, ethical frameworks and guidelines focusing on transparency, fairness, and accountability. Because at the end of the day, all we really need is explainable AI. AI that is able to, AI that we are able to actually see what it does, why it makes its decision, and how it can impact humanity in a way that would be beneficial for all. It's a bold future, and it's a bold idea. Some people are being too pessimistic and some people are being too optimistic, but that shouldn't really be the case. AI is here to stay, and we'll see how it affects us more deeply as time goes on. So there you have it, folks. This was just a dive into the world of artificial intelligence from a cognitive science perspective, really. I hope you enjoyed our conversation and that it actually sparked your curiosity. If you have any questions or thoughts, leave them in the comment section. And if you like this video, please share it with your friends, because that is one way you can support our work here on this channel. Thanks for joining me today, and be sure to subscribe, as I've said that multiple times. Catch you in the next video, where we'll continue to unravel the mystery of technology and the inner workings of AI and how it impacts humanity and the world generally. So thank you, and see you next time. Wilfred, and I'm out.